In this session, I will be presenting regarding a disaster mitigation strategy. Every day, we are seeing in the newspaper the disasters are happening and many people are being killed and the damage also is increasing. So what we can do, how we can mitigate the disasters and what exactly the local self-governance or the local bodies can do in the disaster mitigation is the main part of our presentation. So the frequency and the intensity of the disaster, as all of you know, it's increasing because of the climate change and the global warming. In this present day, we should have a safe and a secure city so that the damage can be minimized, the number of people being killed can be minimized. So what exactly is a disaster mitigation? Disaster mitigation can be defined as a sustained action to reduce or eliminate the long-term impact and risk associated with the natural and the man-made disasters. So it is an action which is taken prior to the disaster, not after the disaster. We have to learn the lessons from the past. After the tsunami 2005, the Government of India has passed an act, Disaster Management Act 2005. So in that, it's considered as a cycle. It's a continuous process of 365 days where we have to identify the risk, where we have to do the preparedness, where we have to respond effectively, and as well as rehabilitation and reconstruction is being carried out very effectively. So why disaster risk reduction or the disaster mitigation is required? The main intention of the disaster risk reduction or the disaster mitigation is to protect the livelihoods and the assets of the communities and the individuals. We have seen most of our cities during the monsoon will be waterlogged. If there is a rainfall of around 5 centimeters or 6 centimeters, 80% of Bangalore will be waterlogged. So what could be the reason for this? Every year it's happening, many people are suffering, many people are dying, but there is no changes we are seeing in this. What could be the possible reason for this? And how we can mitigate this one. So how much we are prone to the natural disaster, the public and the community, as well as the local self-governance leaders also should be knowing about this. So regional distribution of natural disaster, if we consider, the Asia is more prone for the disaster. Nearly 42% of the Asia is prone for the disasters compared to the Europe and the Africa. And 60% of the area which we are living is prone to the earthquake. 12% of the area is prone to the floods, 70% of the cultivable land is prone to the drought in India, 8% of the area is prone to the cyclone. So when we are living in such a kind of situation where we are prone to the disaster, many people doesn't know how much we are prone to the disaster. When we are constructing buildings, nobody follows building codes. Nobody knows national building code exactly. We have conducted a survey in Bangalore in many multi-story buildings where the people or the occupants of that building doesn't know what is building code or doesn't know regarding the fire exit or the fire safety measures. So this is what happens in case of an emergency or in case of a disaster, the more number of people being killed. So disaster management, it's a continuous process which starts with the identification of the risk or the hazard analysis, the mitigation or the prevention. Then comes the preparedness. After identifying the risk, we have to prepare ourselves for the risk. Then comes the response phase. But most of our people think that the disaster management means only the disaster response. So after the disaster response will be the recovery, and after the recovery will be the mitigation and prevention. It's a continuous process, as I mentioned earlier. And what are the important activities that we can do under the disaster mitigation is, the main thing is land use planning. The land use planning, if you take for example, if you conduct a survey in a flood prone areas, most of the occupants are settling there from past 10 to 15 years, even though the flood is taking place every year. Nobody follows the CRZ. Nobody who are settling in the coastal areas doesn't know what is CRZ, coastal regulatory zone. If the CRZ is supposed to be followed very effectively, the damage what was caused in India because of the tsunami in the 2004 would have been reduced to 10%. So human cost of the disaster, if you see here in this part, this is an example which clearly says how developing nations are totally unprepared for the disasters. A Haiti example I will give you, Haiti disaster 2010, nearly 250,000 people have died. In case of South California, where the earthquake took place in the 1994 of an intensity of around 8.5 in the Richter scale, the people who are dead are around 60 and the number of injured were 8,500. In Kobe, Japan in 1995, the number of people died because of the same intensity earthquake was around 5,000. So this gives us the exact picture. If a disaster takes place in a developed world, the number of people being killed will be intense. If it happens in a developing country or an underdeveloped country, it will be in millions. So why this is happening? What could be the basic problem or basic mistake in our people or in these countries? So this is the distribution of the people killed in the disaster. If you see here, the low human development area where the maximum number of the people are killed, nearly 66%. If you consider the high human development area, that's 2% of the people are being killed. So what is important here is the community-based disaster risk reduction strategies as well as disaster mitigation strategy. We should be knowing how to respond to a flood. We should be knowing how to respond to an earthquake. We should be knowing how to minimize the damage at the time of a fire disaster also. So the potential impacts of the disaster vary based on the following factors. First is the density of the population. If you see here in the picture, it's a photograph of Brazil, the availability of the emergency response, then the strict adherence to the building codes, design, and the construction practices. So most of the place when we are constructing building, we don't know which seismic zone we are falling under. Most of the people in our state, Karnataka, thinks that the Karnataka is not prone to the disaster or Karnataka is not prone to the earthquake. But as per the seismic zoning, we fall under zone 2 and zone 3. Means there is a likely chances, not more likely chances, at least a less likely chances of an earthquake that could happen. So what the people will do in case of an earthquake, nobody knows what to do. They will run out of the building, they will jump out of the building. Sometimes they do the wrong things which they were not supposed to do, and the number of fatalities will increase drastically also. Then effective and efficient rescue operation. We should have in advance a disaster management plan which consists of an effective and efficient rescue operation and plans for the disaster. The risk identification is very important. In Karnataka, most of the districts have got a district disaster management plan. They have identified the risk and they have prepared a contingency plan also accordingly. But still, it is at a very grassroots level, very at a basic level. Community should be educated. The ultimate, the person who are going to be affected at the time of the disaster should be educated regarding the disaster and its effects. So if you see these are the photographs of the 2010. If you see this, most of the areas were flooded. We have seen the floods in almost all parts. Even in Rajasthan also, the desert prone area, we have seen floods in 2010. So in such a kind of situation, all the areas, all the places should be aware of the basic knowledge regarding the earthquake, the flood, the mitigation measures, what the measures they should take at the time of emergency. So general mitigation strategies for the disaster, the first thing is the buildings should be engineered to withstand the disaster. So this should be taken care of by the municipality or the corporation which is there while issuing the license. They should see to that they are following the National Building Code. The second one is to develop and keep a defined escape and emergency transit route. If you visit most of the multi-story buildings in Bangalore, you don't see this. You don't see the fire exit. You don't see the escape routes also. That will be blocked or that will be locked. So that should be monitored effectively. Otherwise, during the disaster, the number of the fatalities will increase drastically. We doesn't know how to do the solid waste management properly. We are throwing the plastics that is blocking or choking the drainage, and that is resulting into artificial flooding. Improve the forecasting system. Then reduce the evacuation time also. So general mitigation strategies for the disaster will be to restrict the development and redevelopment in the high-risk area. That's a very important aspect. We have seen the development in an area which is considered to be flood-prone. So that care should be taken by the municipalities or the local corporations there. Educate the public on the mitigative measures. And the Indian Red Cross Society is doing its best regarding disaster mitigation as well as the disaster response. In few slides, I'll be just showing you what exactly the Indian Red Cross Society, Karnataka State Branch, as well as the national headquarters is doing. We have a disaster management center which coordinates and conducts the training, which monitors the situation also. And we have a community-based disaster risk reduction programs which is going on already in 3 states which are disaster prone. We have a mobile disaster units which will be deployed immediately within 24 hours at the time of the disaster. And we have a national disaster response teams which will be specialized and which will be trained effectively as to respond as well as to educate the public regarding the mitigation strategy. We have disaster health response units also, regional warehouse also in the 6 strategic locations throughout the India. We have stored a DP stock also. So regarding the disaster mitigation activities, we have formed a state disaster response team in Karnataka, which is educating the public and the community regarding the harmful effects or the measures they should take at the time of the disaster. We have formed the district disaster response units at the districts which are disaster prone in Karnataka. The first aid training, which is very important aspect at the emergency first aid training for the school children and the youth, that will be very effective or that will be very useful at the time of emergency to minimize the damage or to minimize the human loss. Disaster relief activity, fire and rescue drills. So this has been conducted in cooperation with the fire department and the civil defense also. Public education and training, this is very important aspect. So we, most of the time, we overlook those issues, public education and training, and that will result into more number of casualties at the time of the disaster. So we must shift from a culture of reaction to a culture of prevention, which is more human, also much cheaper. This is what the Kofi Annan, former Secretary General of United Nations, has said. So this is a photograph. You can see here one photograph of a response. The other photograph, the school children are conducting a mock drill of an earthquake. During earthquake, we most of us think that we should run out of the building, but exactly we should stay inside, we should take the support of a table, or we should go inside to the wall. There are many things, do's and don'ts at a time of earthquake. All the people who are in the disaster prone area should be educated regarding disaster mitigation. So finally, to conclude, the disaster mitigation is a responsibility of every individual, the community, the non-governmental organization, as well as the administration. When we work together, definitely we can bring the safer cities and a secure cities.